Hi, I'm State Senator Kevin Parker. I represent the 21st District in Brooklyn, which is Flatbush and East Flatbush, Midwood, Ditmas Park, Kensington, and Borough Park. And today I'm happy to have one of my colleagues with me, Senator Malcolm Smith from the 14th District in Queens. Malcolm, thanks for joining me today.
Good to be here with you.
I've never had you on my show before, so I'm kind of excited about that. But obviously we've been working together. You've been one of my friends and mentors since I've been here, believe it or not, a decade.
Mm-hmm. It's been 10 years?
It's been 10 years, believe it or not.
Wow.
I know. And so, really wanted to talk about some of the things that we've been doing here and some of your visions. Because the things that we deal with, although you represent Queens and I represent Brooklyn, you know, are really statewide issues.
Right.
And certainly
right.
a lot of these things are also citywide
right.
in terms of what we've been dealing with. I recently had Senator Adams on, and we talked a lot about, a big issue in our city, which is stop and frisk.
Absolutely.
And certainly the abuse of stop and frisk is really what we're concerned about. And in fact, a number of us are trying to get together on Father's Day and have a silent rally around some of the abuses of stop and frisk. Senator Adams indicated that, you know, he liked the policy, that it actually is a good policy, it's not necessarily always used the same way. Wanted to see what your take was on it and how you think we should proceed, with the policy.
Well, I think you're right about it. Stop and frisk is something that I do think is a good policy. The application of it, whether or not they stop everybody that could be stopped. I mean, does it mean that just black and Hispanics are the only ones that carry guns or weapons or drugs or a threat to the neighborhoods? I disagree with. I think everybody can be a threat to the neighborhood. I mean, whether you're white, black, Hispanic, Asian, doesn't matter. So stop and frisk, I think it's underrated. In that you find many people like to make it a political football right now. And they, you know, like you saw the stats that came out recently. You've got Southeast Queens as one of the highest gun-toting neighborhoods. You had the 7th Precinct in Brooklyn. You've got several in the Bronx, and actually none in Manhattan.
Right.
There were no areas in Manhattan that had a challenge with guns. So it tells you right away that, you know, while stop and frisk is something that people get upset about, it has its place, but it has to be applied a certain way. So, you know, I'm a very conservative person when it comes to public safety, and everybody knows that. So I believe that if you can put together law enforcement and also some of the community at large, and I don't mean sort of a civilian complaint review board, but put together those two groups and come up with a stop and frisk policy that we can do, but then also everybody understands what it means. And it has to be something that's agreed upon. Right now, you have law enforcement, not to say that they're not intelligent about what they do, but law enforcement makes that decision on their own. I think you need to involve, if you will, some civilians, come up with something that we can agree upon and then move forward. But I do believe in stop and frisk. I think it serves a purpose.
Some of the abuses that people have been talking about is that from 2002, we went from there's actually two issues. Mm-hmm. One, the numbers of stop and frisk, and two, the people who are actually being stopped, right? So, and they were saying that some of the statistics they were quoting was that in 2002, we had about 97,000 stop and frisks reported. And then as of 2009, we went up to over 600,000, which, you know, an exponential increase. And at 78%, of those 2009 numbers were black and Latino, which, you know, and then when only one in every six, actually one in every six stops did they find anything illegal, and only one in every 60 stops did they actually find a gun.
Right.
So hypothetically, if you were running the city, what would your policy look like?
Well, and I'm glad you had that, because that is a sense of profiling. And if you want to get to a quota thing, they have quotas for everybody.
Right.
You know, don't make it a quota where you say, well, you know, black and Hispanics are the individuals that we're going to target because that's where most of the crime is done. You know, and I know some people will argue that, well, you know, there's a lot of crime that's done in the Southeast Queens or the Jamaica area, so that's where we stop and frisk. But at the end of the day, you know, crime has no boundaries. You know, if I'm going to commit a crime, I'll commit it in Briarwood, Queens, or I'll commit it in Upper Manhattan or Brooklyn, wherever I think I can get what I need. So the question becomes not so much the profiling. It's the question becomes, if you're going to do it in the city of New York, then you should do it in a mapping area, but sweep the whole city. You know, don't just sweep the Southeast Queens area, because quite frankly, you could be on the Upper East Side and you might stop and frisk somebody. Maybe they don't have a gun, but they may have drugs. They may have equipment to do what you may call a quote unquote homegrown terrorist kind of act. And if you notice, the homegrown terrorist kind of folks aren't you and I or Hispanics. So there are others who have challenges that can be dealt with. So I think it's more of, if you're going to do a stop and frisk, maybe you don't broadcast it, but I think you take the entire city, you don't separate any neighborhood, and you just, as an internal member to the police department, they might say, well, you know, we're going to do the northeast portion of the Bronx today. We're going to do the southeast portion of Manhattan tomorrow. We're going to do the northeast section of Queens next day. And so that this way, at the end of the day, if in fact your stop and frisk comes to a point where, you know, there's a certain, if you will, disparity between the ethnic people that are stopped, you, at least you can defend it by saying, well, you know what, we didn't choose just one neighborhood. We're doing the whole city. You know, and we do every city, and we can document that we've been in every neighborhood throughout the city over a period of time. And in this way, you can justify what you're doing and not get everybody jumping up and down about discriminatory practices.
You know, that's, I think that's some good ideas. Mm-hmm. And guns and gun violence has really been at the heart of a lot of this conversation. In fact, last summer we had almost broke a record mm-hmm. for numbers of shootings and homicides with, you know, from shootings. Mm-hmm. You've been really at the forefront, at least in the state legislature, around you know, coming up with programs mm-hmm. to deal with this. Can you talk about some of the things that you've been working on?
Well, that, you know, it's a serious subject for us, especially now that we're approaching the summer, mm-hmm. a lot of young folks. And there's two fights to there. One fight is getting into the home and the mind of the individuals that are involved with guns. And I don't know how you legislate that or do that through government. But, you know, that's one side of the coin. The other side of the coin is two programs, of one of which you were very much involved with and it very much helped champion. And that was a program we came up with in 2009, which was Operation Snug, which basically is a gun gang, you know, anti-gun, anti-gang violence program.
What does Snug stand
and
for?
And Snug stands for street intervention. The S part of it is street intervention, where we have people that are trained to go actually into the street and sort of, you know, violence interrupters, if you will. The N stands for the national, state, local support government. U stands for the use of celebrities, which we have done, LL Cool J, Russell Simmons, and a few others. And then the G part stands for gainful employment, which is that psychological part where if you give people more to do, you know, you can get involved with doing other things than gang violence. It has been a successful program. And we did 10 programs around the state. The governor had acknowledged the program to the extent that he funded it again in this budget. We didn't get all of it that we wanted, but it did do enough that Brooklyn, Queens, and Yonkers got some additional money, Albany, as well as Niagara. But in addition to that, we have recognition from other organizations around the city. The Robin Hood Foundation has an interest in it. NYCHA is actually trying to get involved by virtue of using some of the foundations that the mayor has utilized to fund some of NYCHA anti-gang gun violence program. The Rockefeller Foundation has an interest in it as well. And so we will see Snug along the ride for a long time. The current city council speaker is involved with it, as well as the mayor. So everybody recognizes that Snug works in terms of anti-gun gang violence. There's been tremendous articles about the program throughout the city. Even the Post has written about it as being a positive program. But the key thing becomes, what do you do after you get in the head of an individual who is in gangs or has the guns as his nature? What do you do with them after? That's a big piece that we're working on. The new one that has been on the street, which is the phase of it is new, is the gun buyback program. We normally had a gun buyback program where state government or city government funded the program. Well, lately, I created a program called the P3 Gun Buy Program, which is a private-public partnership gun buyback program. The first gun buyback programs we did in Brooklyn, matter of fact. We did three of them. Turned in over 3,000 guns. We did it in conjunction with some of the city council members. And it was three entities. The public-private partnership was the related companies, Steve Ross and them. We had Deutsche Bank, and then we had the UFT, all of which contributed about $25,000 to the program. We are now getting ready to do one just before the summer, which will probably include Queens and the Bronx. And the individuals that are involved right now are Imani Exchange. We have the Sergeants Benevolent Association. We have Donald Trump. We just recently had commitments from the Hotel Trade Workers Union. That's Peter Ward. We have the REBNY, Real Estate Board of New York. And then we have the Building Congress is looking into it. Community Trust, which is also taking a look at it. And we got a couple others we're talking to. But And then a non-financial contributor, which is going to help promote the concept of P3 as well as trying to get more people involved, is WPIX. They're committed to being the marketing arm for the program. And we're going to launch that second phase probably within another week or two. We've been talking to the commissioner and the police foundation, because they actually are the 501c3 that is in receipt of the funding. So we hope that we'll be up to about $150,000 or so between all of those programs. And we're going to do it right before the summer comes, because, you know, there's been a lot of gun activity, and we want to try to do something with our kids, especially since they're not going to be working summer jobs as much.
Right. So in addition to the gun buyback program, mm-hmm. there's obviously a number of issues that I want to kind of move on to mm-hmm. Here up in Albany. Tell me a little bit about, you know, where you are about minimum wage. That's like mm-hmm. a big hot topic that we
have. Yeah, you know, I'm glad you raised that. I was with 32BJ about a week or so ago. I've been sitting down with some of the hotel trade folks as well. And I'm a little different than I think everybody. I told them it's too much soup, ingredients in the soup. Mm-hmm. They got living wage, they got prevailing wage, mm-hmm. and they got minimum wage. Mm-hmm. So my thing to them was, you know, instead of having the prevailing wage, which, you know, you're dealing with the unions and then the living wage with the city contracts, I said, why not take the minimum wage? Instead of making it $8 or $1, I said, make the minimum wage $10, $12. And that's just that's it across the board. Mm-hmm. It's just so many tiers. And at one point, I was having my conversation, it came to me clear that, you know, you can be for living wage, then the folks on the minimum wage part are going to say, whoa, but what about me? And then you do minimum wage, and then prevailing wage says, yeah, but what about me? Mm-hmm. So I said to them, listen, I've got friends in all three pockets. I don't want to confuse, you know, where I am on this. I said, so why not, instead of making the minimum wage $8, which I still think is too little. Mm-hmm. You know, living in the city of New York.
Well, the current, I think
it's $7.25.
It's $7.25 now. Yeah. I think they're talking about raising it up to $9.25.
Yeah. Which is still
$8.50 for if we pass it this session.
Right.
In 2013, it would be $8.50, and then by 2014, it'd be $9.25.
Right. I just don't think that's enough. You got the cab drivers who are out there now talking about they want a 20% increase in just fares alone.
Right.
And that's the yellow cabs. Then you got the cabs that are coming into the outer boroughs, the green cabs, and they're going to be fine. I mean, everything is going up, and it's unfortunate, because if you look at it from an economic standpoint, you can start scaling everything out of proportion. But if you're going to do something to keep the pace, I think you take it up to about $10, $11 and make that it across the board. Mm-hmm. Prevailing wage, living wage, you know, that's a fight related to unions. It's related to, you know, whether a company gets $1 million from the city of New York. I mean, I just think there's too much confusion involved. I think you take the minimum wage, bring it to someplace that's comparable, mm-hmm. so that everybody can do as best they can in the city.
So related to this issue about minimum wage is obviously economic development and job creation. And I don't have a lot of time left, but I certainly want to hear your thoughts about how should we as a state, and particularly in the city of New York, but how should we as a state be approaching the jobs crisis, and how do we create more jobs in the state of New York?
Well, one thing you got to do is make sure that the wages are such that people can be employed. Mm-hmm. But two, you got to give some incentives. I think you take the minimum wage up to $10 or $12, but give them some tax incentives on the business end. Maybe cut down some of the regulations there. Of course, you know, high-speed rail is key for me. I think that's a new frontier for the state. I think it's a new frontier for the city. Whether you're taking high-speed rail down the Long Island Expressway into Manhattan, or you're taking it from Midtown up to Stewart Airport, I think it's going to be critical for us, very much so. But I think what becomes real important for economic development in the city of New York, every borough should have a downtown. Downtown Brooklyn, downtown Queens, downtown Bronx, and each one of them should have hotels and retail, and that in itself creates the opportunity for apartments, creates the opportunity for construction, creates the opportunity where you just don't have a theater district in Manhattan. Why can't you have a theater district in downtown Queens, one in downtown Brooklyn, New York City is big enough. Close to every borough has over 1 million people in it. You have more than enough people to support each and every one of those downtowns, in addition to tourism, which can far way outweigh just going into Manhattan.
Wow. I mean, that's certainly, I think, a great proposal, something that we haven't really heard people talk about. And we certainly, hopefully I'll have to have you back so we can dive more into into the meat of, you know, of that conversation.
Absolutely.
I want to thank my good friend and my colleague, Senator Malcolm Smith, for joining me today, talking about SNUG and gun buyback and the abuse of stop and frisk, but certainly on the minimum wage and job creation, at the heart of everything that we're talking about here in the state of New York. If you need any information, please feel free to contact me, Senator Kevin Parker. And until next time, this is your report from the State Senate.